We've come now to the seventh chapter, and this seventh chapter brings us to what I have given as the theme in my book on Revelation. God seals a remnant of Israel, and He saves a redeemed company of Gentiles during the Great Tribulation. Now, keeping before us, they thought that we're in a book that has been labeled a book difficult to understand, and that it's just a mumbo-jumbo of a great deal of visions that are actually out of this world, most of them, and that no one can understand it. And we made the statement that this actually is the book that is more logical and is divided in a way that no one can miss it, in fact, in a very simple manner. And we have seen that the one thing, though, that is essential, this book happens to be the last book of the Bible. And so when you're studying in school, for instance, you begin with arithmetic, 2 + 2 = 4. Well, you don't start the little ones off today in first grade with atomic physics, and you don't start them off with higher mathematics. Well, the book of Revelation is the last book of the Bible, and the only requirement is to have a working knowledge of 65 books that have gone before. When you do that, why, you'll find that this book makes a great deal of sense, and it's quite logical. Now, we're going to see that as we enter this chapter. We have been looking at the opening of the seven seals. The only thing is, we've only had the opening of 6 seals so far. And we saw that the riding forth of those 4 horsemen of the apocalypse is the opening, beginning of the Great Tribulation period. And that we've come to a period in which the church is never mentioned by name. And the reason it's never mentioned by name is because they're recording things on earth, and at this particular time, the church is not on earth. In chapters 2 and 3, John was told to write the things you've seen. He saw the vision of the glorified Christ, and you're to write the things that are. He was in the church period. We're still in it today. And I hope that we're in it today, because if the rapture's taken place, then you and I have been left. But I think the church is still in the world today, and we are in the things that are. Now the church is to be taken out of the world, and when it is, it won't be mentioned. It was the theme of chapters 2 and 3, the church in Ephesus, the church in Smyrna, the church in Pergamos, the church in Thyatira. But there's no talking to the church here, because the church is not here on earth. We saw it in chapters 4 and 5, the church was in heaven. That's where the church had gone. And I'm going to deal later on why the church cannot go through the Great Tribulation period. There's actually a moral problem here, a theological problem, if the church even entered one phase of the Great Tribulation period, so that the subject is changed. And we're talking about other things, and we were introduced to 7 seals, a book with 7 seals, and the seals are being removed. 6 have been. Now, I think those 4 horsemen introduced the Great Tribulation period, and the 7 seals give an overall picture of that 7-year period of the Great Tribulation period. And the last of the seals bear down on the last 3.5 years of the Great Tribulation period. We'll see how that's divided later on. But here you have brought before us up to this point the fact that 1/4 of the population of the earth was destroyed in judgment, actually destroyed in death. Now, I'm sure that anyone reading Revelation senses the fact that it's going to be very difficult to make it through this period. And especially if you turn to God, if you accept Christ, and if you stand for Him, The fact of the matter is, will you be able to stand during this period? And there are several questions that arise regarding this. Now, John's going to put down here another principle by which he'll follow, because he knows you and I are going to have trouble with Revelation. So he made it very simple for us. He introduces a series of sevens. We've already had that introduced at the beginning. Now, he has a book with seven seals. But the way that he deals with that is the important thing for us to see. That between the sixth and seventh seal, there is always introduced an interval where what would seem to be extraneous matter is brought in, but it is explanatory matter because it explains the action. It answers certain questions. And that's what this chapter is going to do for us, chapter 7, because we have the principle now put down that between the sixth and seventh of anything, it'll be true of the trumpets, it'll be true of the seven bowls of wrath and the seven persons that are introduced, and you'll always find John following this great principle all the way through this particular section of Revelation, so that we don't lose our way. Now, I want to answer a question that would naturally arise. I'm sure that any reasonable person would raise this question at this time. Well, what about people getting saved? How about people turning to God during this period? Because somebody's going to say to me, now, when we were back in 2 Thessalonians, you made it clear from that particular section that the Holy Spirit, the restrainer, is removed from the earth. He has taken the church to present the church to Christ. And so you can't have any turning to God without the work of the Holy Spirit. So will anybody get saved, the Holy Spirit not being present? Well, friends, the Holy Spirit is present. Someone says, but that's not what you said. Oh, I didn't say that the Holy Spirit left the world. I said that he no longer restrained. You see, the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost to perform a specific ministry of calling out a body of believers in the church, and that is called the body of Christ. And when the church is removed, then that peculiar ministry of the Holy Spirit ends. And one of the ministries of this particular era was restraining. I think that it was absolutely essential that he be a restrainer, because the gospel was going to penetrate a Satan-controlled and a Satan-blinded world. Unless the Spirit of God holds back evil, that the word might go out, you see. Just think of the forces of evil that today are working against the getting out of the Word of God. I'm amazed, the first year or two when we moved out here, we just sailed along like a breeze in this broadcast. And then problems came along. And then I got sick and all of these things. And finally, when we regained our equilibrium and began to look around, we said, what's happening? Well, the enemy was busy. And believe me, if the restrainer hadn't been at work, I'm sure that we would have been removed from the scene. Now, during the period of the Great Tribulation, how are people going to get saved then? Because he won't be restraining evil. The Great Tribulation is the devil's holiday. That's the day when he's going to have freedom to do as he pleases. And we're going to see why God's going to grant that. And it's a period of the judgment of God upon a Christ-rejecting world. So does anybody then get saved in the Great Tribulation? My friend, the greatest company, I believe, in any given period of time, this is a seven-year period, I believe there'll be more saved in that period than in any other period in the history of the world. I think that's going to be the great time. And someone says, how will it take place? Well, chapter 7 is going to tell us how. The Holy Spirit is in the world. He was in the world before Pentecost. you find the Spirit of God working in the Old Testament, in the hearts and lives of men and women, and many multitudes were brought to God. But he was not restraining evil in the world. And he was not baptizing believers into the body of the church in the Old Testament. Now, that's what he's doing today. And that minister will cease, but he's in the business of getting men and women to Christ. And he'll have to have a special program, an unusual special program during this period. What's that program going to be? Well, he's going to tell us now. And I'm going to read at verse 1. I hope you have the authorized version. Actually, that's the only version I can honestly recommend today. I much prefer it with notes, however, but be that as it may, I do like to look at the other translations, and I've had the audacity to put in my book of Revelation my translation, although it's not a translation. I've just attempted to bring literal words up and try to say what John was saying, and that's all. And I even made no attempt to put it in a form that would be grammatically accurate in English. I wanted it to be grammatically accurate out of the Greek. And that's my only excuse for doing what I've done. So will you listen now? And I'm going to read several verses here in order to get us into this.